Hey, good news. We have another episode about how architecture is changing. This time we're going to talk about low-code development. So join us on Armchair Architects. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we'll be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they've learned from years of experience that you can use. So today on the Azure Enablement Show, we're doing something we've never done before. We're going to take our script, and we're going to simply rip it up, because we want to talk today about architecture. And architecture is a discussion. So we're back with Uli and Eric to continue our conversation. In our last conversation, we were talking about some of the contexts that seem to have an impact on how on architecture and how and it's actually changing architecture to a certain amount. We talked a little bit about containers. We talked a little bit about collaboration environments. We talked about serverless. And now what I'd like to do is talk a little bit about this other thing that's going on, which is this concept of low code, which I would love to know what you mean by low code, because I can write low code pretty easily. Like here's my two-line bash script, but I bet that's not what you're talking about. What do you mean by low code when you talk about low code?
So the way I think about this is low code is an environment where you can start to build solutions without having to being a professional developer. You still might need coding experience or technical experience, but the tooling is more graphic. It helps you with positioning information. You can drag and drop capabilities into the environment so that your focus is on the business problem because you're a domain expert in finance, in operations, whatever it is. And you're trying to design a workflow and an interaction that optimizes the behavior or the functionality for you. And this is not a new thing. If you think about the Visual Basic of the day, Windows programming was very, 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 very painful because you could only do it in C++ and it was really hard. Visual Basic changed all of that. All of a sudden, there were hundreds of thousands of developers building Windows solutions. Before that were thousands of developers, and it was really complicated. So for me, low code is an environment to think through how do we engage the non-professional developers in a way that allows them to build solutions for their specific scenarios.
So I would love, okay, yeah, go ahead. Sorry, Eric, I want to ask a question, a follow-up question when you're done.
Yeah, sure. I was going to add that what Uli stated is it means that there's a lot of power. We've democratized software development into a designer-driven interface, and we've pushed application development closer to the users and the consumers of that app, which is largely a good thing. There are challenges that I've walked customers through when they start asking questions like, well, now this app is kind of viral within my organization. Everybody loves it, but it's slow and it doesn't perform. And I changed something in the app last week and I broke everything. And that's super bad. So now that my app is super popular, we've got this prospect of having to teach people about application lifecycle management and how to version things and how to deploy things, which is that a conversation that a business user should have once they design these apps or not? The jury's still out on that one for me.
Well, actually the good news is that the new generation of low-code scenarios, like the power platforms of the world and so forth, are offered as a SaaS, as a software as a service product, and not a standalone product that like Visual Basic was. And so therefore, you can actually start to put services and intelligence into it that wasn't possible before. So governance, the scenarios you with a viral application and change management and so forth are built into the service because it's offered as a software, as a service solution. And the other piece that is happening is that a lot of these low-code environments, again, I'm leading with the Power Platform, but there are others, also now support integration with solutions like GitHub, where you can take the software and manage it professionally if you so desire, because you don't have to. The SaaS platform does a lot of that for you. But if you want to say, actually, I have professional code and I have low code, to use these two terms, and I want to manage this consistently because there's dependencies between those things, you can now use solutions like GitHub to do that.
Well, you're answering the question I have in my head is, from a user's perspective, I have my app. I drew it up in my application in my low code environment. Somebody else took that and they're like, hey, I know how to improve upon that. And they made a change there. Or, and a third person's like, well, what's the difference between Uli's version and Eric's version? And I haven't seen, I'm hoping that we're getting to further maturity around that, because we have learned some things around software versioning, you know, at the very least, the ability to be able to understand it. And so one of the places that I wonder about is, from an architectural perspective, are we bringing some of the lessons that we have from software engineering to the low code stuff in a way that, which is, I think, a tremendously hard problem, where we can help people who are not coders understand versions. And
yeah, I think that's the key. We need, so I mean, Uli knows more about this area than I do, but you know, we have, and I'll speak for the Plower platform that I'm most familiar with. So we've got solutions, we've got a backing store and what we call the Dataverse, and we've got source control integration for Power Apps. But I think the gap will be teaching people that didn't grow up in that, you know, capability of a software developer to leverage those components, to educate them that source control should be your single source of the truth, that you shouldn't just be able to just, you know, point people to this URL and then you can change things in the background. I think that's going to be critical.
Again, I will point back to the governance model that's built in. So for example, there are ways for me, if I'm the original author, to prevent Eric from changing things. So there's authorization and authentication that's possible in the system. I can give rights to Eric. I can also revoke those rights centrally. So there's a bunch of things in the platform that helps you. But there's no, we need to certainly continue to be enhancing the governance. The team is currently doing that, or teams, because again, it's not just the Power Platform, and the integration with things like GitHub can help. But that requires IT support, because a normal low-code developer or business person will not know and want to know what GitHub is, and they shouldn't.
Well, so I guess I want to say that you know, I like government stuff very much, but I want to say I'm more towards, and maybe it's just my progressive streak, towards not constricting what people can do, but making sure that, you know, a million flowers can bloom. So I want you to make versions of my thing, as long as we can all play nice together. Like, I want you to improve upon it, not necessarily lock it down, right? Like, which I think is important, and definitely important in a business and in an enterprise context. But I also think, like, if the goal is to tap into this resource of people who know their domain, they just don't know how to code it, but now they can. Like, I want to lean into that as heavily as I can. But from an architectural perspective, and as an architect making, I guess there's, what guidance can architects offer somebody who is a domain expert, but not a coder expert, or even the people that are building the stuff for these people? What do we know as architects that we can give to them is helpful to them? Like, what would you tell somebody, like, if somebody came to you and said, hey, you know, we've got a new low coding thing, you know a lot about building software, I don't know anything about building software, what should I pay attention to as I'm dragging and dropping?
Yeah, I think it's asking well-placed questions. You know, so we want to, I know that I approach it from a position of humility, where I ask questions such as, well, how many people are going to be using this? And where is it going to be deployed? Is it going to be deployed in a specific region? Does it need to go all around the world? And what are some of the dependencies? What happens if this app isn't up and running? And so asking questions like that, that are topical, and you're not just scaring them with, like, you know, GitOps and source control and all these types of things, will actually help bridge the gap and then allow for you to have a conversation about bi-directional, you know, education almost. I thought where you're going with this question, David, was, well, how do architects know whether or not a low code solution is better than good enough versus writing the code?
I like that question too.
My idea is the way I approach, and this might be a personal style thing, but you know, the question I always ask is the simplest choice good enough for, you know, a good 70, 80, 90% of the use cases? And where it's not, how can we fill in the gaps? And then once you're proven wrong, then you say, all right, well, these are the reasons why I can't actually implement the low code component or low code application, that I actually need to invest time in traditional, you know, more well-traveled patterns of software development.
So David, to come back to your original question, how do architects help? It's very simple. The platform is a SaaS solution. So there's a lot of thought that has went in there to enable and expose the tooling that effectively is in this visual designer. So every connector to a database or a SharePoint or whatever it is has been carefully designed so that a casual user, a domain user, can't really overwhelm the system. So there's a lot of the stuff that we talked through the series that's built into the platform itself, because we know we have learned a lot from Visual Basic and Microsoft Access and those kind of environments, and really culminated those learnings into the Power Platform and the dependencies you take. So for me, yeah, should some people that build applications think? Yes, but they should think much more about functionality than about the rest of the stuff. And that, I think, is a really important piece, because the platform itself has templates, has connectors that are pre-designed for you to effectively achieve efficient usage. Is it perfect? Never is, but it certainly is a great start to get really good applications that scale to a very large point, and these platforms will continue to make improvements to get even better.
So let me respond to that with our last question as we come out here. I'm a little hesitant to be as enamored with the blind watchmaker idea. Like, we, the architects, have thought very hard and we have brought down from Olympus this thing, and now we don't want to participate in this, and there's nothing we as architects can learn because we have given you the perfect world. It's your job to use it. What do you think architects don't yet know about low code that they are still learning as we're going? Because I don't think it's a solved problem, right? Otherwise, we'd all be doing a different job. Let's put it that way.
I think the realm that's really being started to be explored is, if it's, let's say, a database or a SharePoint and so forth, a lot of work has been done. But now you're saying, hey, David wrote this awesome microservice or service functionality, and now I would like to expose it into a low-code environment. Now David have to build the connector so that it effectively becomes efficiently usable inside a low-code environment. And we call that the fusion developer or development approach, where you fuse together a professional code that somebody wrote, like you, and low code, where a business domain person wants to change the flow or have a specific user interface, whatever it might be. And this fusion development, I think, is we're at the beginning of this journey of how I take code that anybody writes and exposes it into the low code environment. So they're not carefully curated. They are now masses of developers exposing their functionality into low code. And again, the fusion developer is something that we care about a lot. Good news is that if you, for example, use Azure as your environment for hosting your solutions, you can expose your code using Azure API management. And the API management team is building the Power Platform connector for you automatically. Again, that has drawbacks, because anything that's automatically created makes general assumptions.
Right.
But it is better than a person that doesn't really know how low code works, exposing their application in a way that doesn't scale and so forth. So the API management protects your service and the low code from misbehavior or over usage and so forth. So it's certainly a nice buffer in between your code and the low code environment.
I think, David, I mean, if I can jump in and add to what Uli's saying, yeah, I think, you know, the perception is from an architect or a technical person will hear no low code and assume a lot of what Uli just said. Oh, it's making all sorts of judgments, and I actually can't get under the hood. I have to get behind the seat and just be another passenger in this car, whereas I'm used to actually making these things behave deterministically how I want them to behave. And to that, I would say we need to explore it, because I know from our perspective, the Fusion developer and the Power Platform development experience is actually just accelerating in terms of the number of people that are going to be able to write code. So it's not going anywhere. And I actually, to this day, just when someone says low code, no code, I'm like, but what really I need to do is change that response and say, this is going to actually be something that's productive. It may be viral, maybe super important, and may end up being better because it's closer to the domain of the people that are using it, that will use it.
It's actually far different. I hear you, Eric. And again, if we could write all the applications that are necessary with handcrafted tools, maybe that was the right thing to do.
Yeah. By the way, I'm arguing for this. I'm on the other side.
Well, the problem is that we have a backlog of applications that in every enterprise, I don't know what the numbers are. There's impressive numbers that effectively say the developers that we have, the professionals, cannot write all this code to automate business processes. And therefore, we have to come up with this fusion where the professional developer deals with the things that need super scale, resiliency, self-healing, and customization. Whereas the local person is the business domain person that effectively goes and builds the workflow, the user experience for their scenario on the back of giants, be that David as my professional developer, or be that companies like SAP or Microsoft or whatever, who exposes their capabilities into this low-code environment. Again, for me, the combination is what makes it interesting.
So I think we've run out of time, and I just want to say it's interesting because this connects back to me for the collaboration environments, because Fusion developers now have to understand and contemplate this very unique context that they're writing things in that doesn't behave what they're used to. I know another one of those things has to do with when you're dealing with sort of machine learning and ML stuff. Would you be willing to come back for another video to talk a little bit about that? Because I think we should get into, like, dare I say it, software architecture 2.0?
Yeah, let's do that.
Great. See you soon. Okay, well, we're deep in the middle of this conversation. I really hope you'll join us on the next episode where we pick up right where we left off. Join us again on the Azure Enablement Show.